We are starting a new series. We put Crippled Knight to bed, and so it's time to move on. And so we're starting a new series today, and as you know, if you've been here for any period of time, I'd like to take the first sermon or first message to kind of set things up, about what we're going to be talking about, what it's about, and the takeaways from it, what we hope to gain from this particular new series that we're about to embark upon. So no particular scripture just yet, but definitely it will be filled with the Word of God, no doubt. Amen? Included in our history, in our world history, there are those who are infamously known for acts of betrayal. Okay? In our history books, in our world history, you will find and discover those who are known, infamously known, for the times of their betrayal, whether it's those who committed treason, those who committed espionage, or even those who have defected to other countries and now fighting against us. And these, of course, atrocities have led to the detriment of community, of country, of kingdom, and it's usually for some selfish reason. It's usually based on pride, whether it be envy or jealousy, whether it be greed, or whether it be revenge. My feelings were hurt when they did such and such, or I want what they have, and so I am now going to come against them when I used to be with them. It is based all on pride. There is one particular infamous person that we read about in history, and actually this person is synonymous with betrayal. This person is synonymous. When you say this person's name, you know immediately what you're talking about. And that, of course, is Benedict Arnold. Anytime you hear the name Benedict Arnold, you know we're talking about betrayal. We're talking about treason. Why? Well, it's because of what he did. Benedict Arnold, for those of y'all who don't know, was a general who fought with or in the Revolutionary War. He was a part of the 13 colonies. Well, because of some of his victories being attributed to somebody else, and because of lower-ranking men were promoted above him, he decided to betray the 13 colonies. He decided to try and give up West Point at the time, the bunker there, to the British. And when his plan was foiled, he escaped and defected to now where he is fighting not against the British, but for the British against the 13 colonies. And so now to be called a Benedict Arnold is to have your loyalty questioned. To be called a Benedict Arnold is to have your integrity questioned or to insult your integrity, because just like he came against who was once with him, that is the same way it happens when we are betrayed in our lives as well. And so, of course, this is what makes betrayal so bad. This is what makes betrayal so bad. It's not so much the adversity that we face. We know we're going to face adversity in life. We know things are going to come against us. We know people are going to come against us in life. That's not what makes betrayal so bad. What makes betrayal so bad is not the adversity. It is the adversity by the hands of a friend. That's what makes it bad. It's the adversity when it comes from people who are close to us, people who are friends with us, family members that we have that now all of a sudden turn on us. That's what makes betrayal so bad. Not only is betrayal found in our history, but it is found also in his story. Throughout Scripture, throughout the Bible, you will find time and time again these acts of betrayal. You will find time and time again these stories of those who used to be friends who have now become foes and have come against those they were once with. Starting off with God and Satan, right? You will read about how God was betrayed by Satan. Satan was once known as Lucifer. He was one of the archangels, the top angels. He was the one to usher in all the worship, all the praise and glory to God. He was close to God, the Bible says. But yet he betrayed God. Not only that, you'll read about Abel being betrayed by Cain, his brother. You'll read about Esau being betrayed by Jacob. You'll read about Joseph being betrayed by his brothers. David being betrayed by Saul, Uriah being betrayed by David, and on and on and on until you eventually get to even Jesus being betrayed, of course, by Judas. It is throughout the Bible, it is throughout our history, it is something that we all can relate to. Adversity that not just comes to us, but adversity that comes to us by the hands of those close to us. See, we expect it from our enemy. We expect to be treated a certain way. We expect to be talked about. We expect to have people come against us when they are our enemy, but we don't expect it to come from friends. We don't expect it to come from family members. We don't expect it to come from those who are close to us. What does this have to do with our new series? Well, this is the premise behind our new series called Betrayal. This is our premise behind this new series that we're going to be talking about for the next few weeks. It is the second half of 2 Samuel, and it is all about David now reaping what he has sown. If you were here for the last series, the series on Kryptonite, and we talked about for about 12 or 13 weeks the sin that David had committed with Bathsheba against Uriah the Hittite, where he goes and he takes this woman he knows is another man's wife. He sleeps with her, he gets her impregnated, and he tries to cover up his sin eventually by having Uriah killed. Okay? And so the second half of 2 Samuel is all about David reaping what he has now sown. It is all about David reaping this adversity that is now going to come into his life. But the kicker is, the clinch of it all is that it is not going to come from enemies. This adversity that David is now going to suffer, this adversity that David is now going to go through, is not going to come by the hands of the Philistines. It's not going to come by the Amorites or the Hittites or the Jebusites or anybody else. It is going to come from those in his own family, those of his own household. That is where this adversity is going to come and find David. God does forewarn David of this. We do have one scripture. Do you have your Bible? 2 Samuel chapter 12. 2 Samuel chapter 12, starting in verse 11. This, of course, is when David is now discovered. His sin has been discovered, and God is going to speak to David through the prophet Nathan. He's going to tell Nathan, you've been found out, your sins have been discovered, and so now because you have done this, this is now what's going to happen to you, David. So in 2 Samuel chapter 12, starting in verse 11, through the prophet Nathan, the Lord is going to speak to David. He is going to tell him not only the adversity that is about to come, but also by the hands that it will come from. In verse 11, it says, thus says the Lord, behold, I will raise up adversity against you, watch this, from your own house. Not from the Philistines, not from the Amorites. I will raise up now, David, against you adversity that will come from your own house. And I will take your wives before your eyes, and I will give them, not to your enemies, I will give them to your neighbor. And he shall lie with your wives in the sight of the sun. For you did it secretly, but I will do this thing before all Israel, before the sun. God tells David, David, not only will you now go through adversity, but you will go through adversity by the hands of those closest to you. In other words, you will be betrayed now, David, because of what you're doing. Because not only did David sow adversity by the sin that he committed, he sowed adversity in the life of a friend. I mean, out of all the people Uriah should have been able to trust his wife with was King David. I mean, he should have surely could have believed that King David would never have done something like this. So for David to sin the way that he sinned, not only sowing adversity in somebody's life, but adversity in the life of a friend who trusted him, God says, now you're going to reap that same thing. Not only will you reap adversity, David, but you're going to reap adversity by the hands of those that are closest to you. Now, betrayal is something that most of us can relate to. Betrayal is something that most of us can relate with. Most of us here, I believe, have been betrayed in one way or another. One way or another, we have all been betrayed. We've all been hurt. We've all been taken advantage of. We've all been the way that somebody has come against us, but not so much because they're our enemies, but because they're our friends or they're our family members. And if you haven't been betrayed, if you've never been betrayed, then just keep living. Just keep living, because the only way that you can truly guarantee that you will never be betrayed is that you disassociate yourself from everybody and everyone. So you don't have a family, you don't have any friends, don't join the church, don't work with anybody that you have employees, other employees with. You have to completely and totally disassociate yourself with anybody and everybody. That is the only way that you are guaranteed never to be betrayed. But as long as you are connected to other people, as long as you are a part of a family, as long as you are a part of a job with other people, as long as you do have friends, as long as you are part of a church, the possibility is always there for you to be betrayed. And so it is always there. We can't avoid at least the threat of it. We can't avoid at least the possibility of it. And that's why, for many of us, we have already experienced it. It says betrayal training starts in grade school. I'm sure we all have experienced it at this point in time in our lives. You know, they don't call them mean girls for nothing, right? they don't say that school is like a battleground for nothing. Because there are so many acts of betrayal even going on in adolescence. But we're not talking about stealing boyfriends. We're talking about stealing husbands. We're not talking about cheating girlfriends. We're talking about cheating wives. We're talking about co-workers who have used us as stepping stones to simply get to the top. Who would stab us in the back, who will take credit for our work just so they can get the recognition. We're talking about family members who have treated strangers better than they treated our own flesh and blood. That is what we are talking about in this series, because that's what we have experienced, that's what we have gone through, and that's what needs to be addressed. We are talking about churches. Churches that have been ran by modern-day Pharisees and filled with everyday behavior. I was talking to this one gentleman. I told y'all some of our Bible study before. Talking to this one gentleman, and we were going back and forth. He was talking about the Word, and he seemed so knowledgeable of God's Word. He seemed so close to God and what he was saying and the passion that he had. And so I eventually asked him, said, well, what church do you go to? I mean, where do you worship? Where do you go? He said, I don't go to church. I don't mess with those places anymore. I was like, what do you mean? He said, let me tell you something. I've been to hundreds of bars in my life. I've been to hundreds of bars in my life, and never, not one time, have I been in a fight in one of them. Never. Now, I've been to a handful of churches. I've been to a handful of churches, and I can show you the battle scars that I still have this day from all the abuse that I have experienced in churches. So he says, no, I don't go to churches. I don't step foot in churches. I don't believe in church anymore. Because what were you talking about? He's talking about all the acts of betrayal that happened in churches. You know, you have this one commercial. I'm sure y'all have seen them before. You may have been a part of churches that have used them. But they go back and forth to why people don't go to church anymore. And they go back and forth to why the world says they don't want to go to church anymore. And one of the reasons they give, they say, well, because the world says, I don't want to go to church. The church is filled with nothing but hypocrites. And then what do they come up and say? And there's always room for one more, right? There's always room for one more. Come on in. As to wear that as a badge of honor. Can I be honest with you? I don't want to go to a church filled with hypocrites either. So when a person in the world says, I don't want to go to a church because it's filled with hypocrites, I say, amen, me too. Me too. Why would I want to go to a church that is filled with hypocrites? That's what they're saying. We don't wear that as a badge of honor. We don't say, yeah, I'm a sinner, you're a sinner, we're all messed up, come in, join the party. No, no, no. The church ought to be the one place where you ought to expect to feel loved, to feel accepted, to be treated respectfully. This could be the one place where you can come in and know that you won't be betrayed. But sadly, that's what the church is known for now. That's what the church is known. People believe that they have been hurt and abused and mistreated and betrayed, not in the world, not in bars, but in the house of God itself. So no, I don't want to go to a church that are filled with hypocrites either. I mean, isn't that what John told the church in Corinth? In the church of Corinth, he goes to them, he says, y'all are acting like mere men. You're acting like mere men. You're acting like those in the world where there is envy and strife and division among you. Aren't you acting just like everybody else in the world? I mean, there ought to be a difference in the house of God. There ought to be a difference with the people of God. There ought to be a difference in the place where the Holy Spirit of God dwells. So how is it that you are no better, you are no different than anybody in the world? How is that? Well, I know you're going to say. You're going to say, well, no church is perfect, and church is filled with imperfect people. I know that. I realize that. I understand that. But, you know, that should be the exception and not the norm. The church shouldn't be known for a bunch of Pharisees that are running the place. The church shouldn't be known for a bunch of mean people running the place. I mean, how is it that you have the Spirit of God in you, but yet you can be so mean? I don't understand that. That is probably one of my biggest pet peeves. I don't understand how anybody can have the Spirit of God in them, but yet be so mean. That makes no sense to me. And if you ever want to see me upset, if you ever want to see me agitated and get out of character, claim to be a Christian, claim to have the love of God, go to this church and act mean. Act in a way that is unbecoming of a Christian, of Christ-like, and you will see me that way, because that is one thing I don't understand. It should be an exception because, of course, we're all imperfect, but it should not be the rule. And whenever we see it, it should stand out and stick out like a sore thumb. Everybody should be able to see, that doesn't belong here. That's not the culture of this community. That's not the culture of this church. So whenever you see somebody raising up and talking about people and being mean to people and belittling people and disrespecting people, that should stand out and not be the norm. Oh, we're just a bunch of hypocrites. You're a hypocrite. Come on, our church. We'll be hypocrites together. No, you don't have to be a hypocrite. You don't have to be Christ. You can do what the Word says. You can do what you have said in your own mouth. And you can continue to go and be with God to do what He has called you to do. Yes, you may fall. Yes, you may stumble. Yes, you may make a mistake. But you ought to be man or woman enough and a child of God enough to come and say, I was wrong when I did that. I was wrong when I did that. I was wrong when I said that. I was wrong when I treated you that way. I was wrong when I came against you that way. I was wrong when I got to it. We ought to be able to do that. Even though we make mistakes, we ought to be able to come up and get things right. Because that's what the Bible says. That's what God has called us to do. That's why He has given us His Spirit, that we may live as He did. So no, we are not going to be a church full of hypocrites. Well, the world can feel comfortable because we're going to be just like them. No, we are different than them. In the world, you may have people filled with hypocrisy. In the world, you may have betrayers. In the world, you may have people who will step on you and walk on you and talk about you and be mean and ugly to you, but not here. Not in the church. Not in the house of God. We are called to live supernatural, above the natural, above what you will find in the world. So I'm determined. You may not like it, but I'm determined not to have a church filled with hypocrites. I am determined not to have a church filled with hypocrites. It may be an exception. It may happen here and there, but we better be able to spot it. We better be able to spot it and address it, because I am determined not to allow that to happen. So what we're going to do in this church, we're going to play a game we used to call, growing up, follow the leader, right? We're going to play follow the leader, okay? Paul said this in this way. He says, I want y'all to imitate me. But he didn't say, I want you to imitate me so you can be like Paul. He said, I want you to imitate me as I imitate Christ. As I am like Christ, I want you to be like me. So even though you can't see Christ, even though you can't see God, you can see me. And so as I follow Jesus' lead, I want you to follow my lead. So as a church, if you never see me be mean to anybody, then you don't be mean. If you never see me talk about anybody or gossip about anybody, then guess what? You don't do it either. If you never see me belittling anybody or disrespecting anybody or treating anybody poorly or treating anybody special, if you never see that from me, guess what? You don't do it. If you never hear me gossiping, if you never hear me talking about my spouse, guess what? You don't do it either. You're going to follow my lead as I follow Jesus Christ, and we're going to be a church not filled with hypocrites, but filled with the people of God who have the Spirit of God and know what to do with it. That is what God has called us to do. Because in the world, you don't get that. In the world, you will not get that. But here in the church, it should be. So, why are we bringing this up? Why are we going to be talking about these things, acts of betrayal? Because, again, we've all been hurt. We have all been betrayed by spouses, by children, by family members, by loved ones, by churches, by work, by whatever we've been associated with other people, we've all been betrayed in one way, shape, or form. This will happen, and when it does happen, it will leave us bitter, it will leave us angry, it will leave us resentful, it will leave us cynical, it will leave us in a place where we are unable or unwilling to forgive, to forget, and to ever trust again. We'll be like that one gentleman that said, "I wash my hands of church. I'm not going to church anymore. I'm not going to do what the Bible says." In essence, I'm not going to do what the Bible says because I'm so angry and hurt and bitter that I'm washing myself away. I'm disassociating myself and disconnecting myself from the body as to avoid these things, because that's what betrayal brings. Betrayal will bring all of these things in our hearts and lives when we go through them. And that's why betrayal has brought us to the place where we are today. But even though betrayal has brought us to this place, this is not where we are to stay. And this is the crux of it. This is the point. This is the point of the entire message, the point of the entire series. Even though betrayal has brought us to this place where we're angry and we're bitter and we're resentful and we're cynical and all that, even though it's brought us to this place, that's not where we want to stay. That's not what God has for us. He said, "I want you to move beyond this. I want you to go from being bitter to being better." And we're going to teach you how. We're going to show you through the Word of God of how we can get beyond the betrayal. What do we do when friends become foes? What do we do when those closest to us turn on us and hurt us? What do we do? How do we go from being bitter to being better? Well, that's what we're going to discover through this series. Because David is going to go through it. David is going to go through it. David is going to suffer all kinds of adversity like you wouldn't believe. Hollywood has nothing on the Bible, okay? With these stories that David is going to go through, I mean, it is true, there is nothing new under the sun. He is going to go through it, but the sad thing about it is he's going to go through it by the hands of someone in his own family. That's the sad part, that he is going to be betrayed throughout the rest of this book. And so we're going to spend the next few weeks talking about this as we look into the adversity in his life. Now, there's an old saying that says, we're done now. There's an old saying that says, with friends like these, who needs enemies? With friends like these, who needs enemies? That's somebody who just went through a betrayal. That's somebody who's talking from a betrayal experience. With friends like these, who needs enemies? I mean, I thought I was tight with this person. I thought I was close to this person. I thought this person was my best friend. I thought they were my family member. How in the world could they do this and treat me even worse than an enemy? With friends like these, who needs enemies? It is natural for us to have this response to a betrayal. That is until we realize something. And that is until we realize that God didn't have this response with us. God didn't have this response with us. And if you can sit there and say, "What does God know about my betrayal?" Excuse me? From beginning to end, God has been betrayed. From beginning to end, we can see acts of betrayal, whether it's from Lucifer or from Israel or from Judas or even from us. We see acts of betrayal to God because, you know, we wouldn't have a friend that treated us like we treat God sometimes. We wouldn't have a friend like that. Would you really have a friend if the only time they called you is when they needed something? Would you really have a friend like that? Would you really have a friend the only time they wanted to hang out with you was when they were in private, but in public they acted like they didn't know you? Would you really want a friend like that? Would you really want a friend that didn't like your kids and didn't like your spouse, but they were okay with you? Would you really want a friend like that? Would you really want a friend who would drag you to places that you didn't want to be? Would you want a friend who would threaten to leave you unless you did what they wanted? That's how we treat God. That's how we treat God. But yet God says, I still call you friend. God says, I will still die for you. God says, I will still love you. I will still pour out my mercy and my grace upon you. God didn't treat us that way. And so because we have His Spirit, because we have His heart, that's how we ought to be able to treat those who have betrayed us as well. Now, I know that's easier said than done. I know that, but Pastor, you don't know what I went through. And Pastor, you don't know who hurt me. And Pastor, you don't know what they said and what they did. You just don't know. You're right. I don't know. But He does. And I can guarantee you, whatever you have gone through, it pales in comparison to the betrayal that was upon Him. And if He was able and willing to love, to forgive, to forget, and to move on, to be merciful, and to be gracious, then we, being children of God, being the offspring of God, having the Spirit of God, ought to be at least willing to do the same. Maybe you're not able yet. Maybe you're not at that place where you are able to do it, but at least be willing for the sake of the gospel. Be willing for the kingdom of God. And God says, I just want you to be willing. I know you can't do it, but just bring that to me. I know you don't want to do it, but if you're willing to say, Lord, you're going to have to do this through me, that's all I need. That's what I want. Lord, you're going to have to do this through me. I can't fix my mouth to say it. I can't move my feet to do it, but I'm coming to you, and I'm willing for you to do it through me. God says, that's all I need. That's all I need. But if you want to stay bitter and upset and resentful and cynical and disassociate yourself from anything and everything, you are going to suffer for it. And we're going to see why you want to have this heart of God, this Spirit of God that will bring you to a place where you can do as He did. You can even love your enemies and even the enemies who were once friends. You can't do that if you don't have the Spirit of God. You can't love your enemies if you don't have the Spirit of God. You love those who love you. You're good to those who are good to you. That's the world. You don't need the Holy Spirit to love your enemies. But if you're going to love your enemies, especially those who have betrayed you, that can only come because you have the Spirit of God in you. And so we want to close and give you an opportunity as we wrap up this introduction to this series here. Anybody here, you may say, you know what, that's me. You're talking to me right now, Pastor. Because I've been hurt, I've been abandoned, I've been abused, I've been betrayed by people who claim they love me, claim that they were close to me, claim to be friends of mine, family members, and I'm at that place. And I don't want to forgive them. I don't want to trust anybody anymore. I don't want to be close. I don't want to get things right. That's where they've left me. But as I hear the Word of God, and as I see the heart of God and how He responds to betrayal, I want that too. And it starts with having a new life in Him, a new spirit in Him. That's the only way you can do it. You can't do what is beyond this world unless you have the one that is beyond this world living in you. If you have never surrendered your life to Jesus Christ, as we call the band back and dim the lights, we're going to give you an opportunity to do that at this time. If you have never surrendered your life to Jesus Christ, if you've never said, Lord, this life is no longer mine, it is not my own. You came, you bled, you died for me to forgive me of my sin, not when I was a Christian, not when I was saved, not when I was going to church, not when I got things right, but while I was a sinner, while I was an enemy of yours, you loved me enough to die for me. And I want to receive that love. I want to receive that finished work of the cross that has forgiven me of my sin. So, Lord, I repent. I turn away from my sin. I turn away from the things of this world. I turn away from myself being my own God. And I turn to Jesus Christ, the cross, and His kingdom. I give my life to You, Lord. And I pray that your Spirit will come into me. And then you will renew my spirit with a new spirit. You will bring to life my dead spirit that was severed, that was disconnected from you. And when you bring me back together with you, then I will have the power. Then I will have the authority. Then I will even have the desire, because it is you who both will and to do in me. So when you bring your spirit in me, Lord, I will be changed. I will be like you. And because I am like you, I would want to live as you live. I would want to do as you did, even to our enemies. So if you've never made that decision, if you're here today and you've never made the decision to give your life to Jesus Christ, make it today. Make it today. We're going to ask the elders and their wives to go to the cross. The cross is where it starts. The cross is where it continues. The blood of Jesus Christ and the finished work of the cross is the only power that we have over sin, over Satan, the penalty and the power thereof. So if you need to make a trip to the cross today, we want you to go to the cross. Maybe you're here today, you are saved. You are blood-bought, spirit-filled, on your way to heaven. You are a child of God. But you can say, you know what? I know the old saying goes, like father, like son, like father, like child, but I haven't been acting like my daddy. I haven't been loving like my daddy. I haven't been forgiving like my daddy. I haven't even loved my enemies like my daddy. I've been hurt and cynical, and I've allowed myself to be ruled by my emotions rather than by the Word and the Spirit of God. So I need to go to the cross. I need to make some decisions today about betrayal. I need to say, Lord, I need your heart. I need your Spirit to work in me and through me. Because that's what makes the difference. The world already sees the church as a place with a bunch of hypocrites. That's how the world sees it. But imagine the world seeing a place where everybody is loved and respected and treated kindly and with dignity and honor. Nobody belittled. Nobody treated special. Everybody is just doing what the Bible says. That will stand out, because you don't get that in the world. So I believe my challenge for you today, and God's challenge for us all, is that we move from being bitter to being better. Move from being bitter to being better when it comes to betrayal. Can you say amen? Throw the Lord a hand for his word today, if you would, please. Father God, we do love you and thank you so much for once again giving us this opportunity to gather in your name, to know your heart, to know your will, your desire, and your spirit behind the things that we go through and contend with. God, we thank you that you have become our high priest. The word says that you came and you were tempted and tested on all sides, on all accounts, yet without sin. That means that you were tempted in any and every way as we are, but yet you have the victory over each and every one. So now you have become our high priest who can sympathize and empathize with us. But you also have the answer for us. Just like you were able to overcome betrayal, you have the answer for us and how we too can overcome betrayal. But we must come to you. We must surrender our hearts and lives to you. We must bow before you and yield to you and your Spirit and your way, and knowing that your ways are above our ways. They're higher than our ways, but they are still the better way. So I pray for each and every person here, God, and every decision that will be made. If there's anybody here, God, who has never given their lives to you, never trusted you as Lord and as Savior, I pray, God, as your word has come forth and your Spirit is at work, that you will move them and compel them and draw them to yourself today. And they will make the decision to give their very lives to you, that you may come in and give them a brand new spirit, one that is beyond this world, that is out of this world, that transcends this world, that they may be able to live above this world. And then I pray for those, God, who already belong to you, those who are already your seed, children of the Most High. I pray, God, that you will continue to work in us and allow that sanctification process to do its job, and bringing us to a place, God, where we are just like you. For you said, for those who you have foreknown, you have also predestined to be conformed to your image. Not to have a beard and wear sandals in a row, but to have your very nature, your very character, your very heart. So I pray for those as well who will come to you at this time and say, Lord, I want your heart. I want your mind. I know I have your spirit, but I want your heart and mind. I want to live as you live. I want to love as you love. And in and of myself, I cannot do that, but I want to come to you and ask that you do that through me. And you give me that same mind that you had when you humbled yourself for not friends, but enemies. Humbled yourself and died for those who would betray you, who would wash the feet of all the disciples, including Jesus. Lord, that can only come from you. That can only come from you. So I pray, God, every heart, every person who is called by your name will seek you at this time to have that same spirit today. We pray this in Jesus' precious and holy name. Amen.